Mind strengths in the IMAP mission. An important part of outreach activities for the IMAP mission are what are referred to as mind strengths. MIND is an acronym that stands for material reasoning, interconnected reasoning, narrative reasoning, and dynamic reasoning. It was first coined by Drs. Brock and Burnett Eide in their book, The Dyslexic Advantage, to describe cognitive differences that many dyslexic individuals have in learning, understanding, and problem solving. Our hope is that by adding mind strength options to activities, more people will be reached who have different ways of learning. Up to 1 in 5 people are dyslexic, which means that they're likely to have more difficulty with reading and writing. But as a group, these individuals often have advantages in cognition that include three-dimensional problem solving and divergent thinking. Dyslexic people are overrepresented compared to their instance in the general population in schools of art and design and engineering. One of the goals of these activities is to provide engaging experiences to individuals who have strong talents and skills to bring to STEM. It may also expose others to new ways of thinking and problem solving. To go into each of these strengths in more detail, let's take a look at the first, material reasoning. Material reasoning refers to reasoning through physical materials and 3D spatial visualization. In this next clip from Johns Hopkins Applied Physics Laboratory, Dr. David McComas describes how particle detectors work in the design of the Parker Solar Probe. Dr. McComas is the principal investigator of the IMAP mission.
In our higher energy instrument, we have a whole set of layers of these detectors, and when a particle passes through those layers, it leaves energy in each and every one of those detectors. Those detectors are also segmented in pieces like a pie, and so when a particle comes through from a particular direction, you can tell both the direction the particle came through at, and you can tell the energy and species of that particle by looking at all the different energy depositions. In our lower energy instrument, we also have the same sort of solid-state detectors, but in addition to that, we use an extra trick, which is when the particle passes through a very thin foil, it ejects an electron. We're able to detect that, and that gives us the start timing for the particles.
Hands-on learning is very important for STEM professions, but in traditional K-12 curricula, activities such as reading and writing tend to be overemphasized compared to building or spatial problem solving. Yet these abilities have important contributions to many disciplines, including STEM. Dr. McComas is a good example of how leaders in science and technology can have unconventional paths in STEM. He's dyslexic and had difficulties in school at the beginning. At a Dyslexic Advantage conference on dyslexia and innovation, he shared some of his history.
I'm a lot more comfortable talking about space physics than I am about my dyslexia, but we'll see how it goes. So I'm 55 years old, and when I was growing up, I didn't know the word dyslexia. What it was called when I was young was slow. And it's an interesting term. It's not intended to be derogatory, but you needed some way to describe people who, you know, in fourth grade basically hadn't really started reading yet, like me. And so that was the term that was kind of widely used. I remember from second or third grade overhearing a private conversation that my parents were having, in which my mother said to my father, you know, Mac, we're really, really, really blessed. We have three just very intelligent children. Now, the problem is there were four of us. And I knew who they were talking about. And my father immediately countered, now, Hazelin, you know, it'll be fine. Dave's really tough, you know, and he'll be fine. He'll make his own way. It won't be a problem. And my folks were incredibly supportive of me all the way through, and it was great. But, you know, I was definitely the odd man out in sort of the family plan for how this was supposed to go. But I was doing a lot of other things, and so this is me in fourth grade. And while I wasn't reading yet, I was technically engaged in anything that came my way. I would disassemble and reassemble anything. I built things constantly. I invented constantly. I think I drove everybody nuts. So that they would, you know, take me out and, you know, give me experiences like this where I'd get exposed to this really high level technical stuff because I was so interested in it and so good at it. And so I started to read in fourth grade, and that was good. I'm still a very poor reader, obviously, and can't spell. So, you know, but I read enough to get by, basically. It's no fun, but I read enough to get by. But this, you know, this allowed me, this technical engagement and reading a little bit, allowed me to start really doing a lot of other interesting things. So one of the interesting things I did, and this is a picture of me in high school. Now you can tell I'm already compensating, because I'm compensating for the crew cut I had in fourth grade. But what you see here is that I'm selling jewelry. And when I was in junior high, I started making my own jewelry, silver and gold jewelry, and I started selling it across the Midwest at these various weekend festivals and things. I actually made a lot of money doing that. I considered not going to college because I was making so much money making jewelry. And so I could solder stuff, and I started inventing jewelry in really three-dimensional, very unusual jewelry. But I also got really turned on by physics at the time, because physics was so obviously intuitive to me that I felt like I could really just understand the answers in physics. You'd look at the problem and, oh, well, it's that, of course.
Over 5,000 people were surveyed during the development of the Mind Strengths Framework. They were asked questions about how they thought, learned, and remembered, and whether or not they had been identified as being dyslexic. Here's an example of one of the questions. I am very good at forming 3D spatial images in my mind. 52.9% of definitely dyslexic people strongly agreed with the statement, compared with only 9% of definitely not dyslexic people. Here are responses to the statement, I've always been good at building things. Over 52% of definitely dyslexic people surveyed strongly agreed with the statement, compared to 7% of definitely not dyslexic people. Here are responses to the question, I prefer diagrams or pictures to written instructions or explanations. 70% of definitely dyslexics strongly agreed to the statement, compared to 15% of definitely not dyslexics. In IMAP activities, developing physical models and design prototypes can encourage people who are strong hands-on learners to more fully engage with mission activities, as well as to encourage others to learn how to reason and think through physical objects. It's thought that people may develop more spatial visualization abilities if they first have more regular practice with physical materials. Participants should be encouraged to wonder aloud why things work the way they do and interact with models and materials. The I in Mind Strength stands for interconnected reasoning. This strength refers to talents being able to connect different ideas, objects, or points of view. It may involve interdisciplinary thinking and work, or an ability to take unusual perspectives and to make analogies from different contexts. Here are some examples of interconnected reasoning questions. I often see connections or relationships that other people miss, like how things, people, or events resemble each other or are alike, or in other ways related or connected. 68% of definitely dyslexic individuals strongly agreed with the statement, compared to 28% of definitely not dyslexic subjects. I often think of analogies or metaphors to better understand ideas or to innovate. 56% of definitely dyslexic people strongly agreed, compared to 23% of definitely not dyslexic people. Activities designed to build on interconnected reasoning strengths may look at situations and phenomena in the context of interconnected networks and relationships. Activities using mind maps to relate information or simulations with cause and effect responses or feedback loops can help participants develop interconnected reasoning strengths and, for some, build on existing aptitudes and strengths. Strengths in interconnected reasoning can help when trying to understand why unexpected things happen. The relationship between one event and another may not be clear until a whole network comes into view. Then it may become clearer why one thing happened to cause another. Dr. Mimi Cole is another scientist with dyslexia who provides an excellent example of interconnected reasoning. Her research combines many different fields. She also talks about her early experiences in school, and I hope you'll see that many of these talented people are often overlooked in their schooling and may be overlooked for their ability to be successful in STEM careers.
Interested in the physics of how organisms interact with the environment around them. And to do that, I can't just work in one field. I have to use some biology and some ecology and combine that with some physics and some engineering. So I'm drawing from all different sources to try to get the answers to these questions.
Some of her earliest happy memories as a child involve playing at the beach and feeling the rush of water coming from many directions as the tide would go in and out. Later, this love would become a focus of her work in her studies of animal life in the coral reef. As a girl, she also developed material reasoning strengths because she made doll furniture with her father. Later, this strength would allow her to take an innovative approach to studying marine life by designing unique robots to study the impact of various forces on creatures living in the ocean. What did school look like for Dr. Cole?
Languages, history, literature, those kinds of subjects had lots and lots of reading, and I could never complete it in the amount of time between when it was assigned and we had to do something about it. And words and dates were impossible for me to memorize. So I had to work really, really, really hard and for long, long, long hours just to do okay in those classes, and so I thought I was stupid.
She entered college as an art major, but she had to take biology in order to graduate. Once she began doing science, she found that she loved it and she was hooked for life. Looking back on her dyslexia, Dr. Cole has a positive view.
The ways that dyslexia helped me. I can't read, I can't memorize, and so the only way I can learn things is to understand them, and that has really helped me as a scientist. I'm confused by jumbles of symbols, and the net result is that I'm really slow when I have to do a calculation or put my data in the spreadsheet or whatever, but I'm really careful. And so I think in the end, I make fewer mistakes. It's just like you doing really well in your reading course. I'm bad at this, but I know it, and therefore I'm careful. Lack of confidence, I think, is an asset. I went for 45 years thinking I was stupid and working harder than everybody else just to keep a pace. And I think that's good because I know I have to work harder. So being lacking confidence, I think, has been a help to me. And the other thing is because I lack confidence, what I do doesn't matter. Who cares? And that gives me enormous freedom to be creative. And it was especially helpful for me when I was younger because not only was I stupid, but I was a girl. And so for both those reasons, nobody would take me seriously. So I didn't have to compete and be the smartest scientist in the department. I could do my thing, and my thing turned out to work okay. A lot of us are very good at 3D spatial thinking and at seeing temporal patterns that other people don't see or seeing scales that other people don't see. And for me, that has made it easy for me to couple physics and biology in my work.
Narrative reasoning uses personal experiences and the creation of scenes to explain circumstances in the present or apply them to events in the future. Within the mind strengths context, narrative reasoning draws on personal memory and experiences rather than impersonal, decontextualized knowledge. Here's an example from the narrative reasoning question battery. When I try to recall a fact or concept, the first thing that comes to mind is usually a case, example, personal experience, or image, rather than an abstract verbal definition. 68% of definitely dyslexic people strongly agreed, compared to 30% of definitely non-dyslexic people. A similar pattern was seen in response to the question, I typically reason, remember, and learn better with stories, cases, or examples, rather than abstract concepts or definitions. To engage narrative reasoning strengths, allow participants to have as many first-hand experiences as possible, whether it takes the form of real-time or virtual activities associated with a mission, or undergoing science problem-solving simulation, or learning about stories and people in scientific exploration. So rather than reading a dry definition about solar storms, you can add a personal element to make them feel as if they were there. Stir up participants' imaginations by sharing stories of what happened when a solar storm was so intense that aircraft had to be rerouted. GPS and telecommunications were lost, and SpaceX even lost several satellites. Participants can also interact with such stories by acting as journalists or documentary filmmakers and covering the stories. They can also engage in simulations and scenarios that walk them through the experiences as if they were there. The D in mind strengths is dynamic reasoning. This strength may be the least common of the four, but it's very important to develop. Dynamic reasoning is reasoning under dynamic, changing, ambiguous, and complex conditions. Only 17% of definitely not dyslexic people agreed with the statement, "I'm good at connecting the dots and spotting patterns or processes that others miss." Over half of definitely dyslexic people strongly agree. So what does this mean? Skills such as these are important in all aspects of STEM because they involve pattern detection, negative space thinking or recognizing what hasn't been seen or identified, anticipating problems and troubleshooting, and generating alternative scenarios and forecasting what might happen next. In scientific exploration, new things are always being done, so team members need to be prepared for the unexpected. When unexpected things occur, it's helpful to know that they can be resourceful and creative in being able to solve problems. Decision-making has to occur when not all the information is known, not all the supplies can be gathered, and conditions are changing and unpredictable. Many activities involving dynamic reasoning are thought experiments rather than physical ones. It could take the form of imagining worst-case scenarios, as well as coming up with ways to solve them. Because dynamic reasoning builds on information that can form patterns, facilitators may need to prime the pump or lay groundwork to provide examples if they haven't done these kinds of experiments before. Those who may be good at real-world problem solving may perform the best at first, but others can be brought into the process with whole group brainstorming. The process of scientific invention is to make, test, and revise. So allow projects to continue over weeks so that participants have the experience of trial and error, prototyping, researching, critique, and revision. Dynamic reasoning activities will never have a single answer. The journey is the goal. Great examples of on-the-spot problem-solving that saved missions include the Apollo 13 mission or the out-of-the-box thinking by Jack Kinstler, who saved a Skylab mission. Jack Kinstler was a hands-on learner who never went to college, but went on to become the Chief of Technical Services Center at NASA's Lyndon B. Johnson Space Center. He had the nickname of Mr. Fix-It. Jack had his MacGyver moment when Skylab was jeopardized by a meteorite shield that broke off during flight. Jack pored over blueprints of the lab and found a small camera port near the torn shield and figured out how to make an improvised umbrella that could open a Mylar shield protecting the lab. To prove that it could work, he connected together four fishing rods, a tube, and some parachute silk. The astronauts pushed the invention through the port, the chute opened, the temperature came down, and saved the day. One of the goals of mind strengths activities is to encourage unconventional problem-solving strengths like these. Some participants may have them naturally and may not have ever thought of a career in STEM, while others might need a little nudge to think divergently and come up with solutions when a single answer isn't clear. Educational researchers have shown that one of the most common reasons people say a STEM career is not for them is that they think they aren't smart enough, but that can become a self-fulfilling prophecy. One of the strongest indicators that a high school student will be successful in postgraduate education for STEM is the confidence that they feel in science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. Our hope is that by implementing some of these activities with your participants, you will give them more experience of doing science. There is no single path in science, and the world needs people of all backgrounds who think in different ways. Although this concludes a brief introduction to mind strengths, if you'd like to learn more, visit the library of articles at dyslexicadvantage.org and use the Contact Us page to ask any questions. Happy exploring!